I just went out with my dog, and it's really warm. But I can see that the gradient of light in my room has already shifted. It was just like really bright, and now it's no longer insanely bright. So you can actually somewhat see me talk. I'm not sure if that is an enrichment for your life, but whatever. Video number two of my way too elaborate, rambling narrative about aliens and UFOs. Peter Zion. So he came up with a video, and he basically went on Reddit and he checked what's the stuff with the UFO, and he got a few haphazard quotes and he just defecated out an answer. No idea what he's talking about. He has no idea what talking. He knows that he has no idea what he's talking about, but who cares? He made at least an attempt, and bullshit attempt, but he made an attempt. Okay. In the last video, I just tried to evoke a picture of the sheer statistical unlikeliness of life becoming technological and spreading. The sheer statistical probability that the moment you have intelligent life with industrial processes and spaceships and whatnot, that to go for another solar system, how fast that goes in the universal timescales is shocking. Even if it's 1 light year every 1,000 years, which is not going to happen, but once every 1,000 years you step 1 light year. The question is if it's possible with current societal constraints and whatnot to have a spaceship that lasts 1,000 years or even a few 100 years. I say yes. If you, it won't be nice, but going with societal paradigms of the 1950s and an utter ruthlessness towards individual human lives, the ruthlessness of, say, North Korea, yeah, you could go on to other star systems in centuries. Alpha Centauri, Proxima Centauri, century. Can you create colonies there? Oh, yeah, definitely. A spaceship with all the resources, a large spaceship, and we're talking a couple of hundred humans, and we're talking about fusion reactors and 3D printers. Yes. That would create a colony. And if several spaceships at the same time arrive as a sort of a backup mechanism, redundancy, interstellar redundancy, yeah, you would have colonies. And the colonies would be able to produce space habitats. You wouldn't bother with plants, most likely, but space habitats, asteroid colonies, O'Neill cylinders, in a couple of 100 years. So, a couple of 100 years after Alpha Centauri, or Proxima Centauri, is properly settled. Let's say America was created from nothing in 400 years with wagons and carts and steamboats. And it created, was America from the time of colonization, 500 years, sort of, between the colonization and the first flight to the moon. And now we arrive with technology like 3D printers and proper scientific theory and fascism and all that stuff. And we arrive at Alpha Proxima Centauri and we set out to create a colony there 100 200 years before we have people living in little houses, watching TV, playing video games or whatever, the future alternative from Proxima Centauri, grilling chickens in their barbecue yards in the back of their houses, or an equivalent complex stuff. Radios, talk shows, Jerry Springer, the whole lot. 200 years, maybe even faster. We're talking about crossing the galaxy. With the same technology. So super pessimistic projection, super pessimistic. The whole future will be in the 1950s America. That's pessimistic. And I think we literally will be inundating stellar system after stellar system. Some stellar systems are not that favorable. The center of the galaxy might be a little less favorable. Some stars, like close to a Wolf-Rayet stars, you wouldn't wanna do barbecuing. That's not smart. You can, but chances on extinction are a little bit bigger, close to a Wolfriet system or a, let's say, a mid-sized black hole wandering the galaxy. Yeah, you want to be several light years, tens of light years away from that. So the galaxy sounds like, except for some very discrete quarantini bubbles, you wanna don't want you can handle the most of the galaxy. Human technology of the 1950s can handle most of the galaxy. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous. If you make that assumption, if you make that leap, your mental leap, look at it. The galaxy is a disk of several, probably 200, 300 billion, thousand million stars. Let's say half of that is colonizable in some format. If you like go North Korea, you can probably colonize 75% of that. So the ruthlessness of North Korea, that where a tyrant says, go there, settle, do whatever you can to survive. If you don't survive, it's your problem. They don't survive. Do it again. Go again. Jesus Christ, I have to do my triceps. Do it again and keep doing it. And the galaxy will be mostly saturated by barbecuing humans in less than several 10 million years. We're halfway to the center of the galaxy. That's 50,000 to the edge and 50,000 to the center, sort of. So 150,000 light years ish. Times 100. That's 150,000, 1.5 million. That is 15 million years before we're on the other edge of the galaxy. 15 million years? Let's be pessimistic. Let's make it 30 million years. Oh, 30 million years. We hit some snags. 30 million years. That's nothing compared to the galaxy, to the time scales we're talking about. We're talking hundreds of millions of years or billions of years. First life could have emerged somewhere easily 7 billion years of its first intelligent complex two using neurology life, blah 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 blah, could have merged statistically anomalous faults 7 billion years ago. It could have been spreading their respective part of the Milky Way galaxy. Billions of years ago? Each bubble expanding at a rate of every 100 years a light year. So, colony, and a slowly expanding bubble. Some places they avoid because dangerous stars, black holes, whatever. And then they're across the galaxy, billions of years ago. And we're talking pretty raw industrial stuff. So, I always come back to the example of Alien. If you don't know Alien, watch it and study the dimensions of the ship. The Nostromo in Alien, and this may be a very strange example, but it sort of illustrates the point, is not realistic. It is more realistic than Star Wars and Star Trek. Let's call it that. It's not realistic, but it's Star Trek and Star Wars are not completely consistent with paradigms. Of course, the Nostromo, the spaceship in the movie Alien, also uses some kind of, what do you call it? A shunt, a hyperspace shunt, whatever the hell that is, to travel faster than the speed of light. It looks like we're stuck with the speed of light, or significantly less. We'd probably be able to make 1 to 4% of light speed. Why? Because we are going to burn our engines. We're literally going to incinerate our engines. The output of energy from the engine radiating backwards is going to be hot. It's going to be powerful emissions of something. It can be some sort of ionized, super ionized gas from a sort of antimatter reactor. Look at the movie Prometheus. Sorry, Avatar. Avatar is a lot more realistic than Alien, Nostromo, and whatever. Let's go back to the Nostromo. Nostromo is a spaceship that the tug, the thing that disengages from the platform, just watch the movie, is 250 meters big. And it lands like a building. It lands and there's landing feet, and then people go by elevator to the surface and they walk in spacesuits to another alien ship. And that thing is huge. And it's a tug, which is an archaic concept if you think about it, that pulls refinery rigs that process mineral stuff from another solar system. And it isn't even octanium, it's like little organic compounds or whatever. And it's being refined in that refinery rig in the movie Alien, in the Nostromo, in the refinery, being pulled by the tug across several years of traveling using hyperspeed of some sort. And that thing is 2.5 kilometers big. So the Nostromo tug is 250, and then the refinery is 10 times as big, is 2.5 kilometers. I studied the movie Alien like at length. I love the movie Alien. It's super archaic, it's super outdated, it's not even closely, remotely realistic. Looking a bit further to the movie Avatar, go watch the movie Avatar. You'll see that in the movie when they arrive at Pandora, part one, part two, the spaceship is glowing. The engines are red hot. That's an antimatter drive, which is realistic-ish. There is a guy on internet, you should watch him, he's Bonto Maki or something. He analyzes the output required for that ship, the Venture Star, in the movie Avatar, to make sense. They say it's going to be several years to go to Alpha Centauri. So Earth, 2150-ish, something. The year 2150, so pretty soon, and then the Venture Star goes with sublight speed. So it takes a speed less than the speed of light, which is probably a hard boundary. There won't be hyperspace. If there's hyperspace, this problem becomes infinitely worse. This conundrum. But let's say even with sublight speeds, which is at a crawl in the galaxy, it's very, from human perspective, it's a crawl, taking a long time to go to the next star system and a very long time to go to the other side of the galaxy. But it's possible. The Venture Star glows. The output of energy, Guy Bontofo Maki, that's his name, Google it. An analysis of the amazing propulsion of the Venture Star starship from the movie Avatar. And he comes to the conclusion of, and I didn't do his math because I'm not good at that, but he comes to the conclusion that it's like one Hiroshima-style explosion of push towards the two engines of the Venture Star spaceship every tenth of a second. So it's like tuck, 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 nuclear explosion, nuclear explosion, nuclear explosion, to push the spaceship to a speed that is 40% the speed of light, that is going to vaporize the spaceship. That's going to destroy the spaceship. It could be that we're creating engines at some point that are so violent that the spaceship doesn't survive. That we have to make to tone it down a little. We have to set our ambitions a little lower. So we won't be traveling to Proxima Centauri or Alpha Centauri in 6 years. No, it's going to be 60 or maybe 600. That will definitely decrease the time of travel to adjacent stars. But Avatar is already a quantum leap more respectful of science, antimatter drives, coolant systems, shields up against impacts of interstellar debris, people in cryostasis, settling down with sort of plausible space shuttles on an alien planet. It is sort of respectful of understanding of scientific, it's all still contemporary metaphors, etc. Dancing with wolves, I think, is the metaphor. But it kind of more makes sense. So there will be a future 20 years from now. There will be a future movie about colonizing space, and that movie will be more like a significantly more realistic than the movie Avatar. But Avatar was already setting the realism pretty high. It takes a quite a while to explain what is happening in the movie. Oh, why is that spaceship glowing? Why is that spaceship? Why are the engines aimed at the planet? Oh, it's decelerating. Ah, so you have to put the engines in the direction of your flight. So it moves to this, and then it turns around and it starts decelerating. Ah, I understand. 4 years, yeah, but you need some kind of magical material you only can win at the planet. So before it took 40 years, and now with unobtainium, it takes 4, 6 years to get to Alpha Centauri. Still. Swish, swish, flick. It's still magic. It's still impossible. It's still too much output in terms of energy violence. A spaceship will melt. It's just like, it's too violent. And so we have to think in order of centuries. So most likely, unless whatever. There will be technologies to make it faster, but it won't be under a century for a long time. There, I am going to go on the record and say there won't be hyperspace. Hyperspace makes all this even more insane, off the cuff, completely incredulous. So the universe should have been colonized. And not talking the galaxy, I'm talking all the galaxies you can see, should have been colonized billions of years ago. It would take 2 million years. Probably a bit faster if you go intergalactic. The nearest galaxy is 2 billion years. So that is 2 million years. That would be in the order of several, of maybe 100 million years. Yeah, to go to Andromeda, which if someone started like 1 billion years ago, or several hundred million years ago, they would be arriving about now from Andromeda. They would have to decelerate from probably several percentage of the speed of light with a pretty big spaceship. You wouldn't be able to see that. The kind of deceleration creates stuff you can see. And it would have been just one spaceship. That would be several spaceships constantly coming from Andromeda towards us, or in the galaxy from nearby. There would be a hub of stuff moving around at significant speeds. We are now having the technology that we'd be able to see that. Going back to Alien, the movie Alien, you see a spaceship, the first crude representation of science fiction metaphors. That spaceship is 20 million tons. So you see the beautiful spires of industrial something, 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 meaning, etc., with all these nervies, little plastic bits of tanks and little R2D2s. The model kit of R2D2 was like welcomed on the Nostromo. So they took the model kits of R2D2 and Space 1999. And if you study the Nostromo, that spaceship, you see those little bits of modeling. See little bit of legs of R2D2s all over the spaceship. You see TIE fighters all over the spaceship. You see little bits. Oh, that's a bit of Space 1999, and that's a tank, and that's a whatever. It's very funny. But that thing is 20 million. That refinery rig is 20 million tons, and that's 2 kilometers. That's a big thing. That's a big. That's a big object. And I would say that these objects you see in the movie Alien or in a whole bunch of other science fiction movies are I think they went a little bit over the top with Independence Day 2, like a here's the Earth and here's the spaceship on Earth. That's over the top. Or is it? But Independence Day 1 was sort of I think in Independence Day 1, they traveled at under the light speed. So they took quite a while to get here. There were advanced scouting ships, and then the real ship came, and they didn't travel faster than light in Independence Day. The first Independence Day spaceship crawled over Interstellar space towards us. And then we saw it, and it did some stuff to the moon and very simple cinematics. But that kind of gets the point across. These things, these interstellar voyages, are going to be quite demonstrative and loud and visible. So, what are aliens in this perspective? UFOs. What are UFOs? UFOs make very little sense in this context. It is. Now, what would they be? If we went by the facts, what would they be? What should they be? What could they only be? I've talked it over with a bunch of people, and the first thing that comes to my mind, or to not just me, but to our minds, is time travelers. Because why? The UFOs consistently have humanoids or little gray aliens with hands and eyes and the general proportions. And if one thing is certain, aliens are most likely to be to look like asymmetrical 12-limbed blue cockroaches. The specific shape of the humanoid shape is very unlikely to. There must be a reason for that. So if we go Sherlock Holmes and we look at the facts and we hypothesis, so why would there be humanoid little freaks on board those flying ships? Or for that matter, there's a whole bunch of other ones. Elf-like, 2 meter tall elf-like creatures. There is UFO guys who are allegedly one or two steps removed from the actual US military and all that seriousness. So they must be at some point in their life serious people, and they say, oh, there are dozens of different types of aliens. And miraculously, all of them are humanoid, not blue, eight limbs, eight limbed, asymmetrical cockroaches with I don't know. That is not what we're seeing. We're seeing humanoids. So they're not humanoids. They're actually humanoids that are quite diverse. The little greys are very strange, quite diverse, and the elf, Nordic blonde elf types are also diverse. That only makes sense if it's time travel, or maybe, and we're going really speculative here, alternate dimensions. That's unscientific. Time travel is already pretty problematic, and alternate dimensions is taking it a notch further into the hand-wavium. But we have to explain why there are little bug-eyed, little gray freaks running around doing the anal probing. There's no explanation. I watched the movie Fire in the Sky. Recommended. That movie is that takes it a little too far, they say. It's a movie that you can actually have a feeling of trauma. Ooh, that's scary. The guy gets kidnapped on a spaceship, something, something, UFO, beam of light. He floats up, telekinesis, I don't know, anti-gravity. The spaceship goes somewhere, and he is in a space that is like very crude, and there's corpses of humans there, and there's all this refuge, and it looks pretty alien. It looks pretty out there. Not hearkening back to all kinds of metaphors. You could say that, yeah, that is pretty alien. But then there's this eyes, mouth, angry expression, hands. There's these little freaks again. How come? Well, there's only two explanations. Or three. There's three. Each progressively more ridiculous. Time travel. So from the far future, maybe 50,000 years, some kind of offspring freak come down to our timeline, have stuff here, have meaningful activity, Because spaceships don't need to be that big. It's just like some kind of time travel device. Maybe it's just a little thing that the spaceship, the time travel machine is somewhere else. And then that thing, a canoe or a little exploratory boat, approaches the natives stealthily. They might have their reasons to not disrupt the timeline. Don't get me started. And so they are very discreet. They might be cooperating with the humanity. They might not want to disrupt this timeline. I don't know. I don't know. It's all very contrived. It's all very out there. It's all very speculative. But if we have to, if we really, someone comes with a gun and says, you have to explain, you have to model, you have to come up with an explanation why these goddamn things are humanoid, I would say, kind of. Alternate dimensions, and then the most ridiculous explanation. There was a sort of technological civilization in the past, and they are Atlantis or whatever, and they are back, or they were, are in space, etc. Now, you could go a little bit, if you don't take it from the human descent or the terrestrial descendants, time travel, alternate dimensions, or people from Atlantis, little freaks from Atlantis, there's no explanation. And that resonates with me. I've quoted this one quite a few. I think if it's most likely, let's say the whole universe, the whole galaxy is colonized hundreds of million years to several billion years ago. There are spaceships scattering everywhere. They visited every star system. In many star systems, they have active colonies and industrial bases. And there is a point of saturation for some reason where they stop. Say 40% of the galaxy is more or less settled and 60% of the galaxy is not settled. So there is some prevailing reasons to treat Earth as a quarantine zone. I don't know. Maybe Earth is infected with Cthulhu and they don't want to get too close. They're cautious. Or we are several light years away from a several ten yard years away from a several thousand mass fast moving black hole that is barreling through the galaxy causing major disruptions, and they these aliens or these strange progenitors that started colonizing the galaxy maybe a billion years ago, they have placed sleeper systems everywhere. Now, where would I place a sleeper system? Not too close to the star. So let's say somewhere in the Kuiper Belt. We find Moptic in the Kuiper Belt. We put a dormant industrial structure in there or something. Or maybe it starts small and it just barrels in and then it creates required seed. Maybe several of them. There's like several of these seeds in the Kuiper Belt. Humans start emitting radiation in the 1930s. Or that thing is doing surveillance and says, hey, look at those little, that third planet over there. There's stuff happening. Millions of years ago. So the Incas had already visitors and etc. But the premise is very clear. There is a sleeper thing that arrived here at sub light speed, maybe 150 million years ago or 50 million years ago. It is an emissary, a sleeping seed emissary from the greater galactic civilization. And it starts exploration or this is a naively, superficially an explanation that makes some sort of sense to the unenlightened. And I'm not being arrogant or trippy here. I would say, why doesn't it make sense in the bigger picture? Because we don't see anything happen in the rest of the galaxy. If you look around, you will see if there's industrial stuff happening, there will be anomalous stuff. And right now we have an understanding of science, sort of. Yeah, we're starting to get it. Cosmology, science, etc. The emanations look so natural. Everything that's happening looks so fitting with theories, or you can easily fit it into emerging theories. I know nothing of Dyson spheres. I know nothing of interstellar mining. There is no clear sign. So if they conquer the galaxy, they're doing so at a rate of, they somehow, for some reason, opt to colonize a very small percentage of the galaxy. And the rest of the galaxy, they place observation posts. And what we're seeing in terms of UFOs is strangely discrete and inexplicable things that move in ways which we have absolutely no clue how it would fit with any semblance of an existing understanding of the universe. And I would say that all these explanations, like time travelers, dimensional visitors, Atlanteans, or an emissary sleeper system in the Kuiper Belt or somewhere in the solar system, I don't know, maybe moon, maybe it looks like a giant black monolith, I don't know. Those sleeper observation systems start generating, excreting UFOs with gray freaks, and they come here to do anal probing. I would say, where are they? I want my anal probing right now. I demand, where's the manager? I want my anal probing right now. Makes no sense. It makes no sense. It's really it's hubris. It's a sign of hubris to say it makes no sense, because what do I know? Look at me in 1923. What would the version of me in the year 1923 know? Well, I know a little, I suspect a little, but the version of me in 1923 would be largely clueless. How much more does the version of me in the year 2013 know? Does that version of me in the year 23 even have a body, even have eyes, or is it just a virtual construct of an, or like a largely synthetic AI thing? Derivative of what once used to be a human. I don't know. The amount of progress in one century is so ridiculous that we cannot make definitive statements how much progress we have left of us, we have before us. Could be that we, it's now filling in the empty pockets. There's some progress left, but the outlines are. But it could also be that we have several tens of thousands of years progress at the same rate. That would be unnerving. I have no idea what's going to come in that regard. But I know one thing. If one alien is Grabby, Grabby being, I want it all, and they say, we grab as much as we can, whole galaxy, then yeah, we would see him. You would see him. And if one does it, and maybe 99 don't, that would still mean the complete saturation of the galaxy. How do I explain this even further? I can't. I can't. I've said everything there is to say. 32, 3 minutes. I don't know how many people are going to watch this video. I don't know how many people get it or will get it, what I'm saying. I don't know how many people will agree or get really angry with it. My previous videos aren't watched all that much. Views in the hundreds ranges, not much. My scientific transhumanist stuff doesn't appeal to many people. It's not a really big demographic content. I'm trying. But yeah, it's obscure niche stuff, which I'm saying mostly. I once had a video recently about my visit as a transgender to Berlin and beating up a guy that was sexually molesting me. And I got several thousand views on that one. I don't know how this algorithm works. Maybe there's aliens behind it hiding this content. I love to get in touch with people that have done thinking about this. If you have done thinking about this and you come up with new insights that sort of make sense in a scientific context, or in a cosmological context, please do. I watch Isaac Arthur. I watch what's that New Zealand guy? The beard. What is his name? I don't know. It's FaceTime. He's pretty good at this. And there are a whole bunch of others. The Russian guy that lives in South Africa. What's his name? I don't know. There's a bunch of people that come up with statements that are educated and informed and serious. But there's a lot of people coming up with complete and utter nonsense. In fact, there's a I've an acquaintance that used to live in Elgato, a little mountain city near Mountain View, not far from Mountain View or San Francisco. Recently, she took an enormous amount of LSD, and she was into the UFO stuff. And she came up with these stories about, yeah, in a few years the UFOs will come and they are not friendly and they will kick ass and oh my God, to become the new dictators of the planet. Wow, that's bad news, sweetie. And recently she took a shitload of LSD and she just started running around in a frantic state of hysteria, got kicked out of the house. Let me say there's a whole bunch of unorthodox lifestyles and viewpoints in this scene. And they're not always equally beholden to sane science affirming rhetoric. Respectfully, I say, it's insofar possible. A lot of crazy stuff happening. I live in a planet with flat earthers. I don't know what to say. It's so weird. There's people who still believe that the Earth is 6,000 years old and biblical. I don't know how to make sense of that. Didn't you go to school? But I think I got this is an analysis. I stand behind this analysis. So let me know what you think, if you think anything.